With us wherever you are. I know the Hutchinsons are down in Florida. We'll see them on the screen in a short while. Today we celebrate the baptism of the Lord. This is now Epiphany season. We are at the end of Christmas officially today. Epiphany happened this week on the 6th. We had Russian Christmas on the 7th, and now we're in the season of Epiphany. We often say we're in ordinary time. When we come back next week, we'll see green in front of us and reminds us we're in an ordinary time, but it's also the time of Epiphany that runs all the way to Ash Wednesday. So we have this wonderful time where we're aware of the joy and the peace and the wonder of Christmas and how God has been revealed to the world through Christ Jesus and how we are called to take that good news out into the world. And so it's a very special day today as well because we're also ordaining a deacon and installing deacons and elders today as well. So I call you to be in prayer for them and with me too as well and with them, which is why you see the red here and I have the red on to remind us that the Holy Spirit will be exceptionally present today during this time. My brothers and sisters, I would encourage you to read the announcements for yourselves, which you can find printed in the bulletin, but just to remind you that a walk with Jesus happens today at 11:20 in room 117. The backpacks are being packed this Wednesday at 3 o'clock. If you have any questions or would like to get involved, Adele, where are you? There she is. Please see Adele. She can give you that information. And also January 16, another education opportunity will be happening, and that will be happening on Sunday evenings at 6:30 down the rec center. I would encourage you to read that information in the bulletin, read it out there in Galbraith Hall, get signed up if you'd like to be part of that, and the church bowling party, which will happen in February. What I understand is the bowling alley doesn't have enough shoes, so make sure you got some slippy slidey shoes, but don't wear them in. You want to carry them into the bowling alley. But that other information is out there in Galbraith Hall too as well. So I hope you'll make time to get involved with the wonderful things that are happening here at First Presbyterian Church. My brothers and sisters, as we prepare for worship this morning, remember that Jesus Christ is here in this time and in this place. It is Jesus Christ who stands at the door of our heart and who knocks. And when we open that door and we invite him in, he has promised to come and be with us and to dwell within us. And so, my brothers and sisters in Christ, I invite you now to open your hearts, open your minds as we begin to worship God. My brothers and sisters, please join your mind and your spirits together in silence as I offer our opening prayer of blessing. Loving and holy God, thank you for bringing us safely to this new day. Thank you for the freedom that we experience in coming before you in praise, in worship, and in thanksgiving. We are grateful for this time and for this place that is familiar to us and yet made new in Christ Jesus. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us. May we be filled with your wisdom, your light, and your love, so that our minds and our hearts might be open to what you wish to accomplish in all of us this day. In Christ Jesus, we ask you these things. Amen and amen. Please stand and join together in our opening hymn of praise. Come now is the time to worship. Please be seated, friends. And as we come before God, I invite you now to join together in our prayer of humility, which you can find printed in the bulletin. Loving and holy God, we confess that we are not always able to see your handiwork in the people and the things around us. We do not always see your image in our neighbors, and we do not always see your creative fingerprints in the wondrous things of our world. Our eyes and our hearts are often blinded by our sin, and we too often take you and your loving mercy for granted. Transform our eyes and hearts with your Holy Spirit, so that we may see the light of your creation and the love of your redemption that we have in Christ Jesus. Hear our prayers as we continue in our silence. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen and amen. Friends, Friends, if there's one thing above all else that we want to be sure of in this Christian walk of life, it's the assurance of pardon for our sins. Assurance of pardon refers to our belief that God forgives us because of the mercy promised to us by God in Christ Jesus. And when we trust in God for that forgiveness, we can experience a healing and a peace that goes beyond all understanding. Please join together. Through the waters of baptism, we have died with Christ and are raised with him. With gratitude and with faith, we will walk the way of Christ. And this is the good news of the gospel, that in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Please stand. Please be seated, friends. It's a very special time in the life of the church when we ordain and install officers that we believe have been called by God. We have validated that call through our acceptance of them and their nomination of them and their election of them. And we trust the fact that they have been in prayer to answer that call, and that we have been praying for them too as well. So this is a wonderful time of celebration, but it's also a time of deep prayer. And so throughout this ordination and installation, I would be asking you to be in prayer for the following folks that I will be calling forward to join us, and we will be seeing Ryan Hutchison up here on the screen. I'd also like to invite Kim Rogers to come on up here to the pulpit and call forward down here in front of the Lord's table, Lori Seminara and Annie Hines. Ryan will be up on the screen. Sandy Earle, Jerry Smith, and Wendy Europoli to join me down here in front of the Lord's table. Thank you, Kim. I know we kind of have to turn around and spread out a little bit. You're good. You're going to face the folks. Go ahead there, Sandy. Thank you so much.
Ready?
Yep.
On behalf of the session of First Presbyterian Church, I present to you Lori Seminara, Ryan Hutchison, and Annie Hines to be installed to the office of ruling elder class of 2024, along with Sandy Earle and Jerry Smith, installed to the office of deacon class of 2024, and Wendy Europoli to be ordained and installed as to the office of the deacon 2024.
Thank you so much. I thank the nominating ministry team and their chair, Elder Edie Berner. Edie's not with us today. She's in Sweden, but she's here in spirit and in prayer. I thank her and her leadership and the committee's prayerful and faithful and dedicated work in discerning who is God calling to serve the congregation on session and on the board of deacons. And I thank Ryan and Lori and Annie and Sandy and Jerry and Wendy for answering that prayerful call of the Holy Spirit to serve. Presbyterians understand the position of leadership in the church as outlined in our Book of Order to include the following: lives that have demonstrated gifts in leadership and compassion in spirit, chosen by the congregation to discern faithfulness to the Word of God, Christ Jesus, and those who strengthen and nurture the faith and the life of the church. My friends, as we begin this ordination and installation service, I would ask you to hold these leaders in prayer, asking God for a special blessing upon them so that their gifts will be used for the highest honor to God, that you and they will be baptized by the Spirit of God, and that a manifestation of this grace will be apparent to those serving and we served.
Ryan, Lori, and Annie.
Is he on the phone? He's not answering. All right, Ryan is not here. He's supposed to be here, but he's not here. So we may have to install him later. We don't have much of a choice. Oh, the joys of technology. Go ahead, Kim. Okay. I apologize for interrupting you.
No,
go ahead,
okay.
And start. Feel free to start
okay.
Over, please. Thank
Ryan,
you.
Ryan, if you were here, Lori and Annie as ruling elder candidates, and Wendy, Sandy, and Jerry as deacon candidates, you have been called by God into the service of the church as servant leaders. You are called to serve Jesus Christ and the church through compassionate, joyful, prayerful, and responsible leadership, which reflects on the direction of God through the prophet Micah, to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. And the greatest commandment of Jesus, to love the Lord your God with all that is in you and well in you, and as well as your neighbor, as you love yourself.
Thank you so much, Kim. Lori, Annie, Wendy, Sandy, and Jerry, in light of the charge read to you by the chair of, well, would have been the chair of the nominating committee, we'll say Elder Kim Rogers, do you receive this congregation and your ministries as Christ's gift to the church, recognizing the Lord's provision for the health of our congregation, holding the congregation and your ministries in respect and honor, take the counsel of the congregation seriously, accept their help with thanks, sustain them in prayer, and encourage them with your support, especially when they feel the burdens of responsibility. If so, say, we do. Do you trust in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Acknowledge him Lord of all, head of the church, and through him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. If so, say, we do. Do you accept the scriptures of the Hebrew Bible and the New Testament to be, by the Holy Spirit, the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the church universal and God's word to you? If so, say, I do. Do you sincerely receive and adopt the tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? If so, say, we will. Will you fulfill your office in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by him? If so, say, we will. Will you be governed by our church's polity? Will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? If so, say, we will. Will you in your own life seek to follow Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? If so, say, we will. Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? If so, say, we do. Will you seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? If so, say, we will. Annie, Lori, will you be faithful elders, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in the government of the church and its discipline, serving in governing bodies of the church, and in your ministry, will you try to show the love and the justice of Christ Jesus? If so, say, we will. Jerry, Sandy, and Wendy, will you be faithful deacons, teaching love, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? In your ministry, will you try to show the love and the justice of Christ Jesus. If so, say, we will.
And do you, the congregation of First Presbyterian Church, receive Annie, Lori, Wendy, Sandy, and Jerry as your servant leaders, as Christ's gift to the church, recognizing these leaders as the Lord's provision for the health of our congregation. Hold them in honor, take their counsel seriously, accept their help and thanks, sustain them in prayer, and encourage them in your support, especially when they may feel the burdens of responsibility. If so, say, we do.
All of you who have been ordained as an elder or a deacon, at this time I would ask you to stand and to put out your hand as we offer a prayer of installation and ordination. Wherever you are, please do that now. Unfortunately, with COVID, we can't really get close like we used to and touch each other. Wendy especially is being ordained to this office. This is the very first time she has been ordained to a church office, and so we are grateful for her to answer that call, as well as those of you who have been seasoned in your service too, as well. My brothers and sisters, please turn your attention, your eyes, your mind to our God as we offer our prayer of installation and ordination. Loving and holy God, we ask that you will pour out your Holy Spirit upon Lori, Annie, Wendy, Sandy, and Jerry. Fill them with your intelligence, guide them with your wisdom, and give these leaders that you have called hearts and minds that are discerning, ears to hear you, obedience to understand your perfect will, opportunities to use their gifts, along with the courage to use them with integrity and honesty and dignity of person, filling them with the grace and the peace of Jesus Christ, so that your servant leaders will always be sure of the path, confident in the course, articulate in the gospel, and worshipful in the ministries that you have empowered and called them to do. In Christ's name, we ask these things. Amen and amen. Let's give them a hand of joy and thanksgiving. My brothers and sisters, welcome to the service of First Presbyterian Church. Normally I'd hug you or we'd shake hands or something, excuse me, but I do have, Lori, do have a certificate for you, and we thank Janice for always making this so very, very special. And Annie, and there's a copy of the service in there too as well, so that you can always be reminded to what you agreed to and vowed to today. So thank you again, and God bless you. I look forward to serving together with you. And at this time, I would invite Daniel to come on up here to the pulpit and offer us the word of God.
Our scripture reading is from Isaiah chapter 43, verses 1 through 7. But now, God's message, the God who made you in the first place, Jacob, the one who got you started, Israel. Don't be afraid, I've redeemed you, I've called your name, you're mine. When you're in over your head, I will be there with you. When you are in rough waters, you will not go down. When you're between a rock and a hard place, it won't be a dead end. Because I am God, your personal God, the Holy of Israel, your Savior, I paid a huge price for you. All of Egypt with rich Cush and Saba thrown in. That's how much you mean to me. That's how much I love you. I'd sell off the whole world to get you back, trade the creation just for you. So don't be afraid. I'm with you. I'll round up all your scattered children, put them in from east and west. I'll send orders north and south. Send them back. Return my sons from distant lands. My daughters from faraway places, I want them back. every last one who bears my name, every man, woman, and child whom I created for my glory. Yes, personally formed and made each one. The next reading, Acts chapter 8, verses 14 through 17. When the apostles in Jerusalem received the report that Samaria had accepted God's message, they sent Peter and John down to pray for them to receive the Holy Spirit. Up to this point, they had only been baptized in the name of the Master Jesus. The Holy Spirit hadn't yet fallen on them. Then the apostles laid their hands on them, and they did receive the Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Daniel. Today being the baptism of the Lord, what we celebrate as the baptism of the Lord seems to come awfully fast upon us. We just celebrated Christmas and the birth of Jesus. We have fast-forwarded 30-some years. It's like the Apostles' Creed, right? That comma there is that fast-forward to 30 years. We're used to talking about baptism with children or infants. But this is a different kind of baptism that we hear today. And the focus actually isn't the baptism, although it often becomes that on this day. But we have this lectionary reading, and when I say lectionary, for those of you who may not be familiar with that word, that simply means that the church in its wisdom, not the denomination, but the church universal in its wisdom, has taken the entire Bible, broken it up in a three-year course, so that if you hear it from the pulpit and you read it through the week in year C, in a three-year time, A, B, and C, you have read the entire Bible in a three-year period. And so we are currently in year C. And the reading chosen from today comes to us from the writer of Luke's Gospel, the third chapter, verses 15 through 17 and 21 to 22. And I invite you now to join me in prayer as we ask God's blessing upon the listening and the hearing and the transformation of our mind and our heart and our spirit to this word. And we thank you, Holy God, that at the beginning of time, you set into motion everything that would be required for humanity's well-being, including a sacred word. We thank you for its truth. We thank you for its power. We thank you for the grace that it imparts, for the life that it gives, for the comfort it showers upon us, for the spirit of holiness that possesses all wisdom and intelligence, that has inspired this word, that becomes our advocate on this earth and guides us to the understanding of this word, that we may not only understand it, but it may feed our soul. It may quell our hunger for truth and the knowledge and understanding of you. It might quench our thirst and longing to be alive in you and in this world. We thank you, we praise you for its truth, its life, its food. May we be transformed in this hearing, in the listening, in the understanding, and being obedient to its call. And we ask these things through the power of your Holy Spirit, given in Jesus Christ to us, who has been given to us through the power, mercy, and compassion of our everlasting Father. We thank you, God, for this word. In his name, amen and amen. The interest of the people by now was building, and they were all beginning to wonder, could this John be the Messiah? This is John the Baptist. But John intervened. I'm baptizing you here in the river, the main character in this drama, to whom I am a mere stagehand, will ignite the kingdom life, a fire, the Holy Spirit within you, changing you from the inside out. He's going to clean house, make a clean sweep of your lives. He'll place everything true in its proper place before God, everything false. He'll put out with the trash to be burned. After all the people were baptized, Jesus was baptized. As he was praying, the sky opened up and the Holy Spirit, like a dove descending, came down upon him, and along with the Spirit, a voice, "You are my son, chosen and marked by my love, pride of my life." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. For the most part, I think some of these stories that we read and hear in the gospel, when I say story, I don't mean something that's made up. I just mean that's the way it's being told. It's a narrative. It seems pretty straightforward. I mean, what is there more to say, right? But here's the thing I think we can really be grateful for as Presbyterians, as Reformed Christians. We have a tradition that calls us into particular scholarship, teaching, learning, and understanding, to where we have a Sitzbin Leben, and that's a fancy way, a German way of saying the setting in which the story is given to us. And that just doesn't mean the time and place. That means the history, it means the culture, it means the religious teaching, it means the family line. It means everything. It's the entire setting. It's the nugget of the story that we're given. And we're supposed to look at that holistically. What's happening here? What's happening has meaning. What is this meaning that's being given to us? And why should this meaning make a difference in our life, where somehow we have a desire to apply it in some concrete way that transforms us and gives us hope in the midst of a structure of a world that is difficult to live in, right? So we have this, it's been Lieben. It's a desert, it's out there in the Jordanian plain, and we don't hear it in today's reading. I would encourage you to go back into it and read it in Luke. But John the Baptist is out there calling people to repentance and to a baptism of forgiveness and repentance, and multitudes of people are moving toward him and to this message. Something concrete is happening in a particular place and time, physically, and something spiritual is happening. And these two things together make a difference. Jill Duffield, in her book that we looked at and read this past Advent yesterday in the meditation, she quoted Flannery O'Connor as once writing that when physical fact is separated from spiritual meaning, the dissolution of belief is eventually inevitable. That's why the scripture always gives us some concrete thing: time and place, person's name, numbers of people, year, who's the leader, so on, so forth, so on, so forth. So that we have some facts. We can't prove them. It's been a long time, but that's not the point. What are these facts trying to tell us? What are they trying to show us? What's the picture we're supposed to get within our mind, right? But what we have in this gospel reading today is the testimony of Jesus. I hope we don't miss this. A spiritual awakening is happening to him in the midst of a physical activity. There are a lot of people who wonder why it took 30 years for Jesus to emerge. I mean, the gospel stories tell us that when he was a young boy, he went to the temple and said to his mother and father, "Well, I'm about my father's business." But we don't hear much of anything else about him in that whole time. Did he know he was the Messiah? Did he understand when he was called to? Did his family talk about the kings bringing gold, incense, and myrrh? Did Mary talk about the angel speaking to her? I mean, could you imagine the conversation around the table? Did they talk about it? We don't know any of that. We don't know. We don't know if he questioned it. We don't know, right? But here's what we can know. He moved with the masses of people toward God. That's what he was doing out there. He got in line with everybody else, the same as everybody else. Didn't see himself over and above. Saw himself in solidarity with the people who had a desire to move toward God. That's important. We don't miss that. And so a lot of theologians question, well, it was a baptism of sin and repentance. What did Jesus have to repent for? We say he's sinless. Why did he need John the Baptist to baptize him, right? And a lot of people think, well, it was a ritual, it was a sign, you know, something that he did to be part of us. Possibly, but that's kind of just like Lifetime movie Hallmark card stuff. You know, where's the meat in this? Where's the meaning now? Why does it make a difference now that he walked in solidarity with people in a movement toward God? And I'll tell you, honestly, I really believe the people who have studied this and meditated on this are right on the mark when they say he may have always known in his life that he was singled out for something by God. And most of us kind of can point to this. I always knew there'd be something, right? Always knew there'd be, didn't know what it was, didn't know when it would be. And he, like everyone else, was moving toward God to this validation, to this moment when he would know, what is my true identity? My family may have told me one thing, but is that the right thing? Is that true? And what is the purpose of this identity? And he gets that validation in the baptism story. He moves in solidarity with the people going toward God, right? And here's the thing we can't miss. These people are suffering, and they realize they need to repent and that their sin. And when Jesus walks with them, he is not escaping the tragic structure of the world. And I hope we don't miss that. He walks with us in our suffering and who we are. He doesn't shy away from it. Doesn't like it, I don't think, because it causes such suffering to humanity. But we do have a tragic structure of the world. At the heart of sin is evil. And evil is the opposition of God in the hearts of humanity, which causes us our symptomatic behavior. And I don't think that made God happy at all. And God so loved us that sent Christ Jesus to manifest what the truth and life and way would be. And he is moving out there in that desert, and he has this moment, this spiritual, mystical moment that reveals to him his identity and his purpose. Now, here's the thing I hope we don't miss. At some point, somebody must have asked him, maybe a number of times, maybe his family, probably his family, I would think, his disciples, people who would follow him, maybe religious leaders, how did you know? How did you know? I mean, we all have that, right? How did you know you're called to serve? How did you hear it? How could you be aware? And when God speaks to us in our hearts and in our minds, the Holy Spirit uses our language, our experience. And for those of us who can testify to this, we can point to something concrete that's had some kind of a spiritual meaning that has led to our belief, aha, this is God. And we usually seek some outside validation of this, certainly. And Jesus did that. In Mark's gospel, he runs off to the desert. We hear it later in Luke 2 as well. But when God speaks to Jesus Christ in these moments of his baptism, he's using the language of the Jewish faith and scripture. And this is what God says to Jesus. He uses and quotes Psalm 2, right? He said to me, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your heritage and the ends of the earth your possessions." God quotes, the Father quotes Psalm 2 to Jesus. "Today you are my son. You are my beloved. Today I mark you, I call you, you are my chosen one." And then God the Father quotes Isaiah 42. Now here's 42, 1 through 9. "Here is my servant whom I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the nations. He will not cry or lift up his voice or make it heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break, and a dimly burning wick he will not quench. He will faithfully bring forth justice. He will not grow faint or be crushed until he has established justice in the earth, and the coastlands wait for his teaching. Thus says God the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and what comes from it, who gives breath to the people upon it and spirit to those who walk in it. I am the Lord. I have called you to righteousness. I have taken you by the hand and kept you. I have given you as a covenant to the people, a light to the nations, to open the eyes that are blind, to bring out the prisoners from the dungeon, from the prison, those who sit in darkness. I am the Lord, that is my name. My glory I give to no other. See, the former things have come to pass. New things I now declare. Before you they spring forth. I tell you of them." We don't hear that all in the testimony of Jesus in his baptism, but he would have known that scripture. He would have recognized when God spoke to him that that's what he was saying. And he would have known two things. One, that he was chosen to be king and Messiah by God, validated by the Father, given that power and authority by the Holy Spirit, but from Isaiah, the prophet, knowing, and that actually goes on to the suffering servant, he was accepting a messiahship and a kingship that included power and authority, but not wealth and riches. It would have included suffering. And some theologians believe he would have had a very clear understanding he would have been heading for the cross. That could be a leap, but yet at the same time, any of us who have had the Holy Spirit come upon us, we usually have an intuition where we just know. and Jesus was no dummy. He would have understood to come out in force as a king and a Messiah came against the Roman rule of his time, and he would have been in danger from the beginning, and ultimately, we know, was crucified by that same power. Now think about what that means for us. If he indeed had that understanding and intuition from the very beginning, and he didn't shy away from it, imagine that. Imagine that. That he carried that with such love and compassion, not only for the people of that time, but for all of us and all the people who follow us. Think about the love that that takes to do that. And the hope that we have even today, because he accepted that call in humility and in grace. But here's something I hope we don't miss in this story. In the New Revised Standard, we hear it that Jesus was praying before he was baptized. In some of the other Gospels translations, we hear that he was praying after he was baptized. And don't you just love that? That here was Jesus before his baptism, probably always knew he was chosen for something, not sure what that would be, looking for that identity, looking for that purpose, and he is in prayer. He doesn't even come to it with pride and with a sense of entitlement. And don't forget, yes, we say he was divine, but he was also fully human, and there's a tendency, us humans, when we know we're kind of singled out for something, you know, we kind of want to lean toward that. It's feeling pretty good. Aren't I special, right? And it's really this humble, prayerful stance that Jesus brings to this moment that I hope we don't miss, because this is a characteristic of him. And if we, too, are called to live in this power and authority of his life, we're called to have that same characteristic. To not just assume, because we have been called either to be leaders, to be members of a congregation, of a committee, of a staff, as a pastor, that we should lack in any characteristic that does not include prayer. Right? This is a characteristic that his followers, Christ Jesus, needs to not only show, but to be known by, right? And Luke, we don't hear it named in his gospel, but actually it's Luke Acts. Acts should be right next to Luke, because he wrote the book of Acts too. And if you haven't read that, I would encourage you to go and to read Acts. But it's in Acts that we see this characteristic of the early church gathering to pray. What were they doing? They were gathering to pray, to pray, to pray. Someone was suffering, they gathered to pray. And people were cities were transformed, towns transformed. Because they believed that when they got together to pray, that Christ was in their midst. That person that they had, some of them, known, lived with, been fed by, forgiven, healed, they wanted that presence in their midst. They weren't going to do it without it. And they knew it would be there, especially after Pentecost, by the power of his Holy Spirit. And they weren't going to give that up. They were going to tap into it with everything that they had. And that's another way of people being in community and communion of the Spirit that move en masse toward God. And what happens? The heavens open up and God's Spirit is poured out upon the people and they are changed. That's the other portion of the scripture that I hope we don't miss. We actually have been given this ability. We're called to live in this characteristic, to call upon heaven to open, to pour something out upon us. And what's the opposite of that? You want to live without that? I don't. We're given this as a gift. Isn't that beautiful? That's incredible. Think about that. God didn't just so love the world so that we wouldn't go to hell and suffer. God so loved the world that we would be able to be in communion with God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, each other, and that we would have a power that would guide us continually and transform us and bring us into an abundant life that is full of joy and peace and surrounded in love and filled with grace, even in a structure of a world that is a structure of suffering and evil. Think about that. It's a way out. It's a way in. It's a way to be. Because God so loved the world. My brothers and sisters, I pray as we move forward in this great time of Epiphany in 2022, that we will be strengthened in our identity and in our purpose, committed to God's purpose, in communion with God through the power of the Holy Spirit, showing that characteristic of prayer, so that we too, like Christ Jesus, will have the ability to act from a secure place. You are my beloved. Today I have chosen you. Today I have chosen to pour out my blessings upon you. Today I have chosen to bless you with my Spirit. Today I have chosen to fill you with my grace, surround you with my love, fill you with my peace. In the midst of a tragic structure of a world, this is an act of solidarity in Christ, who we know is with us, works through us, within us, and surrounds us with the power of his Spirit to call us to the purpose of God. And I hope this Baptism Sunday and this Epiphany season, you discover this incredible gift, the beauty of this gift, the wonder of this word over and over again, that it refreshes your soul, it strengthens your faith, and fills you with confidence to face the life that you have been given in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah and amen. My brothers and sisters, I invite you now to join together and stand together in our hymn of grace, Baptized in the Water. Please be seated, friends. And as we come into this time of prayer, please remember our leaders we have ordained and installed today, and also our leaders who continue to stir our staff the changes that are already in place here for 2022. For our brothers and sisters in this congregation that are suffering, for the Payne family and their extended family too as well. For those joys and concerns listed in our bulletin, and globally for our brothers and sisters, especially in Pakistan, that are dealing with severe weather and the deaths that have occurred because of that. Remember, my brothers and sisters, we come into a time of prayer knowing it's a characteristic of Christ Jesus, and that when he went into prayer as we do, that he believed as we can, and I hope we do, that God is there ready and willing to meet us exactly where we are, exactly with the words that we speak, answering back to us in our hearts and in our minds and in our spirits, in the language we understand, in the imagery we understand, so that we might believe it is God who is speaking to us, transforming us, hearing us, working within our requests, our lives, and our prayers. And we thank you, loving God, that prayer is a living activity. We thank you for the grace that you impart to us when we come before you open and ready and willing to accept what you have to say to us in the way that you guide us, knowing that even in the deepest joy or in our darkest moment, in our sadness and grief, in our questioning, you accept that, you accept us. And you choose to work within us to draw us into your truth so that we may be comforted and find peace and hope and strength and courage. We thank you for the life of this congregation. We thank you for the leadership you continue to call forward, to empower, to strengthen, to fill with your wisdom, compassion, and mercy. We thank you for the gifts, for the talents, for the time, for the economy that continue to pass through First Presbyterian Church. We dedicate all of that to you this day and this entire year of 2022, all of its worship to come, its ministry, and its programs, its people, and those we serve. That those who are called to direct and use these gifts will use them, directed by your Holy Spirit. That our leaders will be filled with your compassion. That the gifts and talents, time and energy will always be used for the good of people, the good of the world, the good of your church. We thank you that in your mercy and compassion, you surround the grieving with your angels of comfort, and that you give us hope for the moment that you are here, that you have always been here. You have been here from the beginning. You will be here in the end. You draw all things unto yourself and make all things new. And we thank you and we praise you, Lord, that as we lift our deepest concerns to you, our greatest joys, that we believe you hear them, those that are written and shared, those that are spoken, and even those that we keep within the deep silence of our hearts and our minds. We pray that you will overshadow all those who make decisions that affect the lives of others, that you will fill their minds and their logic and their intellect with your wisdom and intelligence, so that the decisions that they make will always be made for the good and well-being of the people they are called to serve, to care for, to teach, to guide. That you will surround those who are lonely, who are sick, who are struggling, who are addicted, abused, and homeless, who are struggling in systematic poverty. That you will open our eyes to see each other as you see us, valuable, beloved, redeemed, worthy of your presence, your grace, forgiveness, goodness, and love. And might we be known as people who not only reflect the goodness of Christ Jesus, but present him as our life and truth and way, in what we see and say, the way we live, what we do, in the ways that we worship and believe. As we lift before you all of these things, Lord, we trust the fact you take them into yourself, and by the power of your Holy Spirit, we believe that life is truly transformed, so that we might rest assured that in the end, that all shall be made well, all shall be made well, all manner of life within Christ Jesus shall surely be made well. And we believe that you hear us now in the prayer that Christ Jesus has given to us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and power and glory forever and ever. Amen and amen. My brothers and sisters, please stand, join together in our closing hymn, Sweet, Sweet Spirit. My brothers and sisters, everyone is warmly welcome to move out to Galbraith Hall after the service today and enjoy some cake. We thank the deacons for providing this today that honors our newly ordained and installed folks to their leadership positions. My brothers and sisters, remember that you have the living God within you, the kingdom of God within you, Jesus Christ, the resurrected Lord within you. You are called to take all of this out into the world and to never be afraid. For it is Jesus Christ who strides out before you. He goes ahead of you. He prepares a place for you. He waits there for you. And when you lose your way, I guarantee you, he will turn back on that road to meet you. And I bless you now in the power of our living, loving Creator God, our Abba Father, who loves you more than you could ever imagine. And Jesus Christ, who is the living revelation of this life and truth and way, and the power of the Holy Spirit that has the power to bind you to God and to one another. Hallelujah and amen.